Hello, my dear students. How are you all? Good. Taking good care of yourselves. Eating lot of mangoes. I know what all you're doing at home. Okay. So now, last time we had completed the leaf part and had already I have already sent you a worksheet to be solved. So after that, now my biology lectures will be coming on Thursdays and not on Tuesdays. Okay, so this Thursday you are getting, so again next Thursday you will get the next bio lecture. There is a slight change. Today we are going on to the next section of the parts of plants, and that will be after leaf. Now we are moving on to flower. Alright, so today's class I will not be able to complete the entire structure in flower, since it's little big, and I want you to understand it slowly and gradually. We are not going to rush through, so I will be taking two parts today, and let's quickly begin. I hope you are ready with your pen and notebook to note down certain doubts if you have. All right, okay, let's start. I know if I ask you, do you understand what is a flower? You all will probably giggle, smile, laugh and say, what miss? Of course we know what is a flower, right? But today we are going to look at the flower with a very different view. The view being, we are going to study about the flower as a scientific organ, all right, as a part of a plant, and a very, very important part of a plant. Of course it makes the world very beautiful. I don't think that the beauty of the flowers can be compared to any other beauty. I think that's one of the best ways, you know, to feel good. When you have lovely flowers in front of you, you feel really, really good. But today, moving away from that aspect of flower, we are going to understand what exactly does the flower do. Why has nature created flower? Okay, so what is flower? Your answer will be, the flower is the reproductive part of a plant. The flower is the reproductive organ of a plant. Did you get that? It is because of the flower that the plants multiply, the plants reproduce. But that also means that there are so many plants which do not have flowers. Then how do they reproduce? Of course, there are many other ways of reproduction in the plant world. We have a different form of reproduction called as the vegetative reproduction, vegetative propagation. You remember in the last slide of leaf, bryophyllum, we had studied about bryophyllum. What was that? Vegetative reproduction by leaf. So all the plants which do not bear flowers also definitely multiply, reproduce, but in the tree of evolution, in the plant kingdom, the plants which are having flowers are supposed to be at the topmost level. That means they are the most evolved plants in the plant kingdom. Okay, the most advanced ones are the floral plants, the plants which bear flowers. And what does the flower do? It is the reproductive organ of the plant. Then of course the next two points you are well aware of. Even for your help, I have displayed different types of flowers, some in clusters, some are solitary. What is solitary? In single. So flower is the most colorful and attractive part of a plant. Different types of plants have different types of flowers. Some brightly colored and some are white, whereas some are scented and some might be without a fragrance. Okay, so there is a variety. Now we have to understand the structure in a very different way. Let's see what the structure of a flower is. The parts of a flower are also called as the whorls of a flower. I want you to note down this word, whorls. I don't want any error when you write it down. It is whorls, whorls, whorls of a flower. So you may call it as parts of a flower, but the right term, the biological term for this is whorls. And there are four whorls of in a flower. If there are four whorls in a flower, we call it as a complete flower because all the four whorls are present. And we will see later that there are flowers which are incomplete, means they do not have all the four whorls. Okay, so what are the four whorls of the flower? Calyx, corolla, androecium and gynoecium. All right, so I have shown you here calyx, corolla. We are going to see in details each, but for now you understand calyx, corolla, androecium, gynoecium. So these are the four whorls, and you will have to remember the four whorls in this order itself. No changing the order, like calyx, gynoecium, corolla, androecium, or calyx, androecium, gynoecium, corolla, corolla, androecium. No. How you will remember? Calyx, corolla, androecium, gynoecium. Okay. Now, why I am saying so? Because their arrangement on the stalk of the flower is in that manner. First there's calyx, then there's corolla, and then there's androecium, and then there's gynoecium. All right. So it has to be in that right order. And if you learn it in this order, I'm telling you, you will never forget calyx, corolla, androecium, and gynoecium. Is that clear? So these are the four whorls of a flower. The first one is calyx. What is calyx made up of? The calyx is, first of all, the first and the outermost whorl of a flower that consists of sepals. Can you see the green colored part? Okay. So the name of the whorl is calyx, but what are its members? The members are called as sepals. Is that clear? So what is calyx made up of? Calyx is made up of sepals. So what actually you see, this green colored part is the sepal, and they will always protect the flower in the bud condition. So when you see a bud, it is usually green in color, and as the bud matures, the petals start forming. You will see that the petals then become larger and the sepals remain smaller. But when the flower is just forming, we call it as a bud. So that is completely green. And why it is green? Because it is covered by the sepals. So what does sepals do? They protect the flower in bud condition. Clear? All right, you understand? So which is the first whorl of the flower? Calyx. And it is also the outermost whorl. What is it made up of? Sepals. And sepals, what they do? They protect the flower in bud condition. All right, can we move on to next? This is the most attractive part of the flower. What is it? Corolla. Well, don't make a mistake. You will not say corona. It is corolla, right? So please focus on this 2L here and don't replace it by the dreadful N. We do not want to see corona. We want to see a beautiful corolla. So corolla is the second whorl of a flower consisting of petals. Okay, the second whorl and consisting of petals. How are they placed? They are just placed above calyx. Then in most flowers, the petals are colorful and attractive, right? Why are they attractive and colorful? Which will help the insects to be attracted towards the flower for pollination. So when I give you a question as in the corolla is attractive or the petals are colorful and attractive, give reason why. What will be your answer? The petals are colorful and attractive to attract insects for pollination. Is that clear? Now, sometimes some flowers are very sweetly scented. There's a lovely fragrance, especially now it's summer month and jasmines are all in blooms, you know. The different types of jasmines are in bloom and they have a very, very sweet fragrance. That also helps the insect to attract for pollination. Alright, so in that adjoining picture or image, you can see that there's a lovely butterfly trying to, you know, suck the nectar. And while doing so, the pollens will get attached to the body parts of the insect. And then when it moves to the other flower, it will carry the pollen grains. Alright, so Corolla is the name of the whorl, and what are the members called as? Petals, which is the second whorl and placed just above the calyx. Is that clear? Now, let's see how the corolla is arranged in terms of calyx, or rather how the petals and sepals are arranged. Now see here, I have placed two flowers. One is a buttercup and the other one is a rose. Okay, so petals, first of all, understand the petals may be separate or joined together. They can form even a bell-like structure, all right, or cup-like structure, and they can be individual petals. In some plants, the number of sepals are equal to the number of petals. Can you see, can you count? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. These are 5 petals, and count the number of sepals. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So, many flowers will have the same number or equal number of sepals and petals. Whereas, in some flowers, the petals are much, much more in number than the sepals. And see here now, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. There are 5 sepals, but petals are innumerable. There's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, so many of them, right? So, the petals here are more in number and the sepals are less in number. And in fact, you know, sometimes even one entire bunch of, the flower actually is called as an inflorescence in biological term. So, if it is a solitary flower, it is like this, you know, one single pedicel or the stalk will have one flower. Whereas, there are so many flowers in one stalk or one pedicel, there will be so many small number of flowers. Now, just see here, this is one single stalk, but there are small flowers in this bunch, alright? So, this is one more type of inflorescence or a flower where there are small flowers in one bunch. And the other one that we have seen, the solitary one, are the single ones. Alright? So, that is all for today. The structure of the flower, only two things we have studied. Why I have focused only on two things? Because the next two things are little more technical. So, for today, you will only understand the first two whorls, which are calyx and corolla. Calyx being the outermost and the first whorl of flower. Corolla is the second whorl. Calyx is made up of sepals and corolla is made up of petals. Petals help the flower make attractive, colorful, scented, and attract insects for pollination. Alright, so that's all for today. Next time I will continue with the remaining structure of flower. Bye.